Oh my god. Hi everybody, so today I chose a video on my own and it's 5 historical misconceptions from CGP Grey. And I chose this video because we did 10 misconceptions from Sam yesterday. So I'm kind of in the mood to discover or to see those misconceptions. CGP Grey is a phenomenal channel. Go check him out. I'm going to put a link in the description below. If you don't know him, he covers, I don't know, politics, elections, everything. History, science, YouTube, everything. Okay, without further ado, if you want to join our community, just hit the subscribe button and the notification bell. And for those who are asking, I'm going to upload also a new video about Napoleon today. Okay, so let's jump into the video. La.
Number 5, Vikings. What would a Viking be without his trusty
helmet
and its impressive horns?
Of course.
The answer is a more historically accurate Viking. Think for a moment about what wearing headgear like that into battle would mean. The horns are just easy targets for your opponent to hit and knock off your helmet. Or if you strap on your helmet, now your opponent has a convenient lever with which to drag you to the ground and something to hold onto while slitting your throat.
Unpractical.
Horned helmets are a terrible idea, which is why archaeologists have never found them at Viking battle sites and there's no evidence that they were ever used. It was poets and artists, people not known for caring about facts and reality, who gave the Vikings their silly hats during the late 1800s, long after the Vikings could correct their misconceptions. Number 4, yep. Lady Godiva.
Okay, about the Vikings, yeah, that, I think it's one, besides the pyramids in Egypt and the slaves, I think it's one of the bigger misconceptions, especially in Europe. I read through 2 archaeological findings near Oslo and Denmark, somewhere in Denmark, and they didn't find any helmets. There are possibilities that some units or some individuals had, you know, like horns or whatever gear, but it wasn't a common thing. Historians and archaeologists think that maybe they used those horns, you know, like in some rituals or something like that, but definitely not in battle, because as he said, it would be unpractical. And one thing you also need to know is the Vikings raided Christian lands, and the devil has horns. So of course, it went into the idea to depict the Vikings with horns because they represent the devil, to pump up, you know, like support against the Vikings in Christian lands. So it's logical. Okay, Lady Godiva, Great Britain.
The story of this 11th century English noblewoman is that her mean husband, the Earl, raised taxes on the townspeople of Coventry, which Lady Godiva, and not surprisingly the locals, thought were too high. She badgered her husband and he conceded in exasperation to lower the taxes if she rode through the town naked, assuming that she never would, but she did. Because people don't like taxes,
Lady Godiva.
Lady Godiva's story lives on, notably in the Godiva logo and in popular songs. But while Lady Godiva was a real person and Coventry is a real town, there's no record of her nude ride from the time when it happened, so we can safely assume the story is false. Just as with the Vikings, again, poets and artists are to blame who made up the tale long after Lady Godiva's death. Number 3, Napoleon.
Look at the term Peeping Tom. Peeping Thomas or Peeping Tom. It's one of the most famous records of voyeurism in history. But yeah, as far as I know, I'm not sure like who researched that or whatever. But as far as I know, Lady Godiva was a firm Christian and she also spent a lot of donations to the church. And I don't think she would have done it because, you know, like she was such a woman of faith. And, you know, like nudity and, you know, like display of the body at that time was kind of seen as anti-Christian and so on. Just think about all the sculptures that they tried to nullify the Christians of the Greeks and Romans who depicted, you know, like the human body in a naked way. Okay, Napoleon, France. What? The height? I would say it's the height. I would say it's the height.
Famously, this tiny, tiny general, perhaps to compensate for his short stature, took control of France, greatly expanded its influence, and dubbed himself emperor. Napoleon's official height was indeed 5'2", but at the time, French inches were longer than English inches, so doing the unit conversion, Napoleon's height should have been reported as 5'7" in England's imperial units, which is short by today's standards, but was average or slightly above average in the early 1800s. However, England, with its eternal love of all things French, didn't care and went with the Napoleon is so short, LOL, version of the story in newspapers and cartoons. Meanwhile, Napoleon was busy introducing the metric system to France and the wider world to standardize measurements so this sort of confusion would never happen again. And thankfully, the whole world now uses metric. Mostly.
Nah.
Sort of. Number two,
US,
Roman
bonnet. US, what are you doing? That's also a misconception, but he was depicted mostly, as he said, by British journalists as short, just because they needed to, you know, like prop up the propaganda, because Great Britain was one of the biggest enemies of Napoleon and France back then, which dated, you know, like centuries, you know, like British and French, they're arch enemies in history. He was actually pretty normal for his time. So I don't know what to add to that. He was normal for his time. Okay.
The Roman Empire, so great and powerful, but corrupted by decadence from within. And what could be a better symbol of that decadence than the vomitorium, where Romans, after stuffing themselves with delicious foods, could vomit them all up again to make room to feast anew. Vomitoria are real, but this idea of them
the
is
Colosseum.
Not so confused,
okay.
Is understandable, because their name, vomitorium, seems to make their purpose so clear. Even if for some reason you know Latin, perhaps because you live in a country that insists you waste hundreds of hours of your life learning a dead, useless language, this knowledge still won't help you because the root word vomitum means to spew forth. So what is it really? If you've ever been to a big stadium like, say, the ones made by the Romans, you've already used a vomitorium. This is what the vomitoria are, the passageways that let lots of people enter or exit at once. The people are what spews forth in the vomitoria, not the contents of the people. Number one, Columbus.
Okay, Sam did the same point about the vomitorium, but as I said, I didn't research it yesterday, but I'm going to definitely research it today. As far as I know, the Greeks did puke out their food. I'm not sure about the Romans, and maybe the room where they did it, or the place that they did it, wasn't called a vomitorium. Maybe it was called, I don't know, vomitora or something like that. But yeah, I don't know if he said. I mean, the exit from the Colosseum, yeah, it was called vomitorium, but maybe the place where the Romans vomited, maybe it was just called something else. So maybe they did they did puke after a feast. Okay, Columbus. Okay,
there's
America
so very
again.
Much wrong with the common retelling of the story of Christopher Columbus that it's hard to know where to begin, but the biggest misconception is that everyone else thought the world was flat, but Columbus was the only guy smart enough to know that it's round. It makes a daring story, but knowledge of a spherical Earth goes back to at least 5,000 BC. That's 6,500 years before Columbus set sail. And that knowledge was never lost to Western civilization. In 200 BC, Eratosthenes calculated the Earth's circumference, and his estimate was still well known and being used during Columbus's time. The argument Columbus had with Queen Isabella was not over the shape of the Earth, but of its size. Columbus estimated the Earth was much smaller than Queen Isabella and her scientific advisors did, which was why he thought he could make it across the empty Atlantic to India. But Columbus's size estimate was wrong, again, just like Napoleon's height, because of mixed up units. However, this mistake did send him west to become the first European to discover America. As long as you ignore the hornless Vikings who beat him by 500 years.
Yeah, the Vikings were the first. Yeah, about Columbus and the flat earthers back then. No, in academia at the universities, if you look up, so Columbus was in the 15th century, but when you go way back at the universities, it was the spheric theory of the Earth was acknowledged and it was widely spread. Maybe the population, you know, like peasants and so on, thought that that the Earth was flat, but the spheric idea of the Earth was actually pretty known between the academia. You had in the 11th century, you had Hermann Contractus. In the 13th century, maybe one of the biggest impactful persons in theology and theory or whatever, in the inside of the church, Thomas Aquinas, 13th century. So you see, like centuries ago, it was a common a thing amongst, you know, like educated people to know that the Earth had a spheric shape and not a flat shape. But as I said, maybe in the general population, alongside the not so well educated, let's call them that way, maybe it was, you know, like the flat earth theory was accepted. Okay. Hope you enjoyed it. If you didn't watch the Salmonella 10 Misconceptions, there's going to be a link up here somewhere in the corner, I think in this corner. If you want to be part of our community, just hit the subscribe button, notification bell. We're almost at 10,000. Woo! A big milestone. Thank you everyone for watching, for supporting, for being part of this community. It's great just to see your input, thoughts, opinions, everything from all around the world. Okay, until the next video, see ya.